I think it's all working.
Okay.
Okay.
And I think I'm okay here.
And I believe this is Ham Radio Now, episode 240-something, maybe 247. Could be something else in between. And I'm sitting here at the very end of the Charlotte Hamfest. There'll be nobody left in this building when we're done, except for us three. And us three are me, Gary, KM4AQ, Dr. Jim Boner, Roanoke Division Director, N2ZZ for the ARL.
Greetings.
And Jeff Parker, WA1WXL, who I'm not going to be beating up about DMR this time.
Very good. Thank you, Gary.
Because you're here to talk about something else.
That's right.
We're going to talk a little bit about the Charlotte Hamfest right off the bat. A couple of years ago, I talked to the guy who was the chairman at the time, Brian, K1NET, K4NET.
K4NET.
And it was the first year, I think, that you guys had changed from a Saturday-Sunday Hamfest with a dead Hamfest on Sunday.
Correct.
To a Friday-Saturday Hamfest.
Right.
With not exactly a super bombastic Hamfest on Friday, but not dead, far from dead. So tell me a little bit about that change.
Well, I mean, the change was mainly to try to bring in more hams on Friday because, you know, Sunday seems to be a day that it's real difficult to get people in because of, you know, church and family gatherings and stuff going on. So the idea came was to go ahead and let's try Friday night or Friday afternoon, Friday evening and see how things work.
So you open up at 3 on Friday.
Three on Friday, right. And, of course, I'm a member of the Cabarrus Amateur Radio Society, which is a supporting club for the Mecklenburg Amateur Radio Society. And you know, we help out with numerous things here at the Hamfest. One would be setting up tables and stuff like that. But, you know, it seemed logical to try the Friday night, Friday afternoon, Friday evening, just because, you know, it would allow people to get in there and, you know, they're coming home from work on Friday or maybe coming to decide to want to spend the whole weekend down here, come down here to Charlotte and, you know, get something going early. So
it was a gamble, though.
It was a gamble. I mean, we've done this on other places before. In fact, I think Raleigh's done it in the past, if I remember correctly.
Not in my memory.
Okay. Well, it seems like I remember sometime back and back.
Well, Raleigh switched from Sunday to Saturday.
Right.
But that was a change foisted upon them by the venue.
Right. So. Mm-hmm. I remember back when I was running it up there back in the 80s, we did have a Friday night when the computer thing was a real big thing. But anyhow, I mean, it takes and gives people a chance to come down. You know, on Friday night evening, you know, it doesn't mess up their whole day Saturday if they have something going on. And, you know, do shopping for amateur radio stuff, electronics, whatever else.
So how has it worked out?
I think it's worked out fairly well. I mean, you know, it's better than a just one day ham fest. It's, you know, from the standpoint of, you know, ticket sales, I mean, I think it's worked out pretty well. From what I've been told, I mean, this is what I've been told from the Mecklenburg County guys. It seems like it was more this year than it was in the past.
Yeah, my recollection of the first year on Friday was it was pretty dead. Mm-hmm. You know, I was like, oh boy, I hope this works, but it's not working today.
Mm-hmm.
But now, a couple of years down the road, Friday was pretty good. I got some video, some B-roll video that I'll stick on here, showing what the crowd was like on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And the aisles weren't jam-packed,
but
there were people here, and
right. The
flea market was starting to gin up.
Mm-hmm.
And now I've got a couple of stills that I took that I'll put as B-roll here of Saturday. And you can see that Saturday was a whole lot more crowded,
as
you might expect. Jim, what was your... Do you remember the first Friday that they did here?
I haven't been able to come on Fridays because I work the
nine
until 12. Yeah. So I get here very late. But I do remember the Sunday. The last Sunday I was here, I could probably count on two hands how many people actually showed up.
Yeah.
And so I think this was a real positive thing. Most of the hamfests I go to are on Saturday, and of course we like the Saturday and Sunday just because I can attend both. But I think for this area and this club, the Friday-Saturday format has worked out very, very well. I've got a lot of very positive responses from that.
Yeah, there are certainly people that can, like you, can only make one day. Mm-hmm. I can't get away on Friday. But to have nobody here on Sunday and a fair number on Friday, it's, you know, overall for the Hamfest, pretty good. Brian was talking about saying, well, it's his recommendation to any two-day Hamfest that has a pretty dead day or maybe a one-day Hamfest that would like to add a little more time.
Mm-hmm.
Friday can work.
Yeah. The biggest thing on Friday is trying to get dealers in here, because some of the dealers, you know, obviously they have real-time jobs and 5 days a week. So, you know, to get up here, it's a little more difficult. Same thing with some of the manufacturer's representatives trying to get in on a Thursday versus a Friday to come in. I mean, it's a little bit more of a challenge. But, from a vendor standpoint, it may be a little bit more difficult for them to get here on the Friday night. But, you know, for the most part, you know, I think overall, I think it's turned out pretty good.
Not very many Hamfests are trying that yet. Of course, Dayton, which sets its own standards, mm-hmm. has always been a Friday, Saturday, and a half a day Sunday. Orlando had been Friday, Saturday, and half a day Sunday, and they started at noon on Friday. This was your first year at Orlando, right, Jim?
This was, and I usually go to Dayton every year. So I came in on Thursday. I looked around the Hamfest. I was thinking, this doesn't look really big. And then the next day, oh my gosh, this is incredible.
And Dayton is, of course, mobbed on Friday.
It is.
Because it's a destination. Mm-hmm. You know, everyone plans to take the time off.
Mm-hmm.
But Orlando this year opened at 9 o'clock instead of noon, and it seemed to work for them. They were the ARRL National Convention, which is, I think, why they did it.
Yeah, and when you said 9 o'clock, we took our picture a little before 9 o'clock, and the place, as soon as those gates opened, was mobbed.
So we may see Orlando. I'll have to get Peter a call and see if they're going to keep opening up at 9 o'clock on Friday. But that, I mean, it is something you've got to plan for. And maybe not an inconvenience, but something you've got to plan for. Because I typically would roll in Friday morning mm-hmm. with a stop overnight someplace. And now I'll have to roll in Thursday. So Friday's not too bad a deal. Now, Orlando is the land of retired people.
Right.
Dayton is the land of... You just go.
It's the Mecca. It's the ham radio Mecca, basically. And, you know, I mean, it's like everybody just goes there. And, you know, I've been up there numerous times, too. And, you know, Friday is just as bad as Saturday. And, you know, obviously I think it trails off on Sunday somewhat, you know, just because of people moving in and out. But,
but I've always said that Sunday at Dayton has a bigger crowd than most ham fests have on their busy day.
Mm-hmm.
And they would... kill for Dayton's Sunday crowd.
Well, of course, it's the flea market out there that's the big draw. I mean, that is just a massive flea market. And I've always been told, if you see something you want, you better buy it because you'll never see it again.
You'll never find your way back.
That's right,
And if you do, it's going to be gone.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's too bad that we don't have this problem everywhere, but, I mean, you know, it's just that the way the world is today, you know, I mean, it's not...
But here in Charlotte, you don't have either a lot of retired people or... the mega draw that it's just the place to go. So that's why Friday was quite a gamble.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's also not huge on Friday.
Right.
Because you just don't have the people that aren't working.
Right. I mean, I think you have it starts out at, three o'clock, and you have a slight dribble coming in. And, of course, as it gets to quitting time, 5 o'clock, you know, you kind of have a surge coming in at about 5 to 6, and then it just trails off at going at 7. Same thing on Saturday morning. I mean, Saturday morning, the doors open, I mean, it's like a wave, you know, it just kind of goes through, and you wave from one end to the other, and then, you know, as I said, it starts to trickle off after probably about lunchtime.
Okay. So, you Hamfest sponsors out there, if Sunday has been dead, or you want to, you know, add something to it, to a one-day Saturday Hamfest, think about Friday. I know in Raleigh we'll be thinking about it because the setup is Friday afternoon, and there's a lot of people milling around mm-hmm. that we're not getting any money from. So, you know, we've always, you know, kicked around the idea, well, why don't we open at least in the evening? So that might be something to do. Jeff, we got something else we want to talk about, two other main things that we want to talk about that I'd love to have your opinion on, and you're probably going to say, well, I don't really know very much about this.
Okay.
And that's because most hams don't know very much about it and don't have solid opinions about it. One thing I consider to be fairly innocuous, not a big deal. And one thing, at least for some people, it's going to be a pretty big deal. So number one, lifetime licenses.
Lifetime licenses. Well, like everything else, you know, since we don't have to pay for any licensors renewals, you know, it kind of makes sense.
I guess I should mention that this is a, it's there's a petition before the FCC.
Right, right. The FCC. I remember reading about
okay,
it.
Okay, so you do know about it.
I do know about it. Yeah, I do know about it. And I have read the ARRL, you know, bulletins that come out in regard to that. And
the comment period is open as we sit here and until March 22nd. Mm-hmm. So the FCC wants to hear your opinions about this. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's not hard to do. Doesn't cost anything. If you don't feel up to doing it yourself, it'll cost you a few bucks to have one of the services do it for you.
Mm-hmm. I guess the only thing when you say lifetime, what is considered lifetime?
Until you're dead.
Well, and yeah, I know, but that's the problem is, though, I mean, somebody will have to let somebody know that, you know, that you have passed on or whatever the case may be. Yeah. So, you know, there has to be some checks and balances there to know, okay, when that license is expired. And now, of course, with a 10-year, I mean, obviously, if you don't renew it after 10 years, you know, it automatically goes away. But, you know, that's the only thing I see, that they'd have to come up with some way of being able to determine, you know, if that person, you know, has passed on or whatever the case may be, so that that call sign can be regurgitated, recycled, whatever the case may be.
Yeah. Jim?
Well, I thought of a couple of things after you had mentioned that to me, and I appreciate getting the topic ahead of time just so I had a chance to think about it. The news bulletin here, if your listeners would like to comment, it's RM11760, and this was a petition for lifetime radio licenses.
Yeah, it was filed by a ham named Mark Croats, who I can pronounce his last name correctly because his voice appeared in my documentary Digital Voice for Amateur Radio. I was in Dallas at the time, and they were showing the networking to me, the guys in Dallas on the K5 TIT system, and Mark showed up from someplace, I think he was in New Mexico or Arizona, and there we were linking on D-Star from Dallas to the city that he was in, and I had his call sign, and I only had his name in text, so I called him Mark Krotz, K-R-O-T-Z. It's okay. Mark Croats. And I don't remember his call sign now. Is his call sign written down?
No, this was just the bulletin. This wasn't the actual... But there were a few things that had come up. First of all, the ARRL hasn't taken a specific stance or whether or not they're going to add reply comments, but there were two things that I thought of. One of the things that has already been brought up is just the fact that once someone's... This was brought out on general radio telephone operator license, which really doesn't have much attached to it other than something you would use for a resume or for a job or whatever. So it certainly would make sense for the general radio telephone radio license to be lifetime. But with amateur radio, a call sign is attached to that. And because the call sign is attached to that, if it is a lifetime license, how do you clear out the FCC database?
Yeah.
If someone,
how do you clear it out now?
If I think after the 10-year point, there's one...
nobody renews.
Right. After 10 years, I believe a year later, that call is dropped back into the pool again. And then from that point onward, if someone does get a license in that second year, then they would have to have a reissued one or get a vanity license. So the database automatically gets cleared out. But if someone ends up becoming an SK or dies, anyway, a little bit.
Hamfest is coming down around
little,
us.
Little bit of QRM here.
I'm waiting for him to take the drapes down behind you.
But if that person dies, that call sign would never get reissued if they were not reported as such. Now, of course, the FCC could say, okay, if you're 110 years old, we're already going to clear out the database, but that's one of the implications. And seeing that there are premium call signs out there, 1x2 and 2x1s, particularly in the four call area, they may never get reissued.
Well, 1x2s and 2x1s, someone is going to be watching like a hawk.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, as I was reading over the comments, I did a smattering of reading of the comments that had already been filed. And that's clearly what most people have got their eye on. It's, I want a 1x2. And I'm waiting for a guy to die, and I want that call sign.
It's almost like getting an apartment in New York City.
Yeah.
Yeah, to wait in line.
Yeah. I screwed up badly. I had KN4AQ, and I thought, you know, K4AQ would be a nice call to have. Mm-hmm. And the guy who held K4AQ died. And yep. I wasn't watching.
K4AQ here. So anyway, that was the first thing. There's something else that's potentially much more important, and that is in the terms of amateur radio enforcement. With amateur radio enforcement, it apparently is a procedural nightmare to revoke one's license. If someone is a repeat offender in amateur radio, that person usually will be declined renewal. And that's the way the FCC has done this in a number of cases. And if there was a lifetime license, then it would probably be a nightmare to have someone's license be revoked. So the way procedurally now, it would not be compatible. It would save the FCC a lot of time, and as the petition here notices, but I think in terms of enforcement, it would be a nightmare.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it saves them anything, because I don't think that there's any human fingers involved in a renewal.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I think it goes back.
Climb
you
up
know,
on that, Mike.
Yeah, it comes back to the definition of lifetime, and you know, if you consider a lifetime until birth to death, or if you consider a lifetime, 20 years, 30 years, whatever the case may be. I mean, that may be better, for the FCC from the standpoint of being able, as Dr. Wana said, to recycle those call signs and stuff like that. Yeah, I think it all comes down to, what the FCC can handle as far as from the manpower standpoint and how it affects their, the administration stuff. And there's a number of different things, as he indicated, that's going to have to come into play on this issue.
It's beginning to sound to me like there might be more manual intervention with lifetime licenses to clear them out than mm-hmm. there is with 10-year licenses to get them renewed. Mm-hmm. And again, it's easy to do, although a lot of older hams who don't have the computer skills aren't equipped to renew on their own. So,
yeah. In fact, I just had one amateur today come up to me and say, "Well, how do I renew my license?" And he says, "Is there some forms I have to fill out, or what do I have to do?" And I says, "No, it's all online now. Just log on and fill out, get your ULS number, and go ahead and do it.
And try to remember the password that
that's
you
right.
entered 20 years ago last time." Okay, so Mark, I think I'm sorry. I don't think this one's going to go through. I mean, I just consider it to be what's right. the big deal, one way or the other, and lifetime, mm-hmm. Sounded okay, mm-hmm. but it does sound like maybe it's not quite so okay.
At least a few concerns.
Yeah.
So before we get to the big meaty issue, maybe it's a meaty issue, mm-hmm. we should talk about the Amateur Radio Parity Act for a moment.
The Amateur Radio Parity Act has been working very well. The HR 1301 and S1685, we've had a number of people meet with their representatives. I think we are up to, if I remember right, probably 123, co-sponsors at this point, mm-hmm. maybe more. The individuals working on it, the people that are up on Capitol Hill, our director from the Hudson Division, Mike Lysenko, has been extremely helpful with this. Our legal counsel, Chris Emley, has been very good. The individuals we deal with, I have to admit, I have some trouble with name blocking. I deal with these things all the time, but of course, as I'm trying to bring them to mind, it makes it a little bit difficult. But there have been a lot of visits. We have encountered some opposition, but not much on Capitol Hill. We did get through a Senate subcommittee hearing. I'm very happy about that, and it's moving forward.
Yeah, it's now before the full Senate. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have any more committees to go through mm-hmm. in the Senate. It has one more in the House, which should be coming up soon, the Energy and Commerce Committee.
Mm-hmm.
And that could happen, in any time within a month or so. Greg Walden, as he pushed it out and waved goodbye from his committee, the mm-hmm. Communications and Electric Toasters Committee. The other kind of toasters are just, put it over fire. Electric toasters are important. Communications and technology. Mm-hmm. I'll give Greg that much. This is a real committee. So it left there intact, but it didn't leave there to stay intact. Other than people who watch ham radio now, I don't think anybody's paying any attention to the fact that The opposition is the Community Associations Institute. And way back in February or maybe January, when there was the hearing in the Energy and Commerce Committee, in the Communications and Technology Committee, mm-hmm. when they had that hearing, the ARRL filed comments, and the CAI, not the CIA, the CAI, filed comments, and in their comments were seven specific things they would like to see changed. That's the only clue I've got right now. Now, you're on the board of directors of ARRL. You must have inside information about this.
Well, as far as inside information, I think most of it is public. And I think the one thing that we definitely want to keep intact is the ability for the community associations to just not be able to say no. I think that's the one big goal that we have.
Just don't say no.
Exactly. In other words, there has to be some reasonable accommodation. CAI is not happy with that language, and the ARRL has been trying to work to try to be able to find something acceptable, but the one point that is the strongest point is that we don't want the just say no.
In their filing, I don't have instant total recall about it. I did get the impression that they were kind of capitulating to the idea that no was off the table.
Well, you know, it's what's really interesting is the fact that I think it's got a lot of momentum here over the past year, which is a good thing. And I think it's going to help out a lot, especially a lot of these amateurs that are, you know, in areas that are very difficult for antennas and locations and stuff like that. I think it'll help out in the long run. My concern is that it doesn't get watered down and get hung up with another bill when it finally gets to the point, you know, and then all of a sudden, you know, you have to go back and do damage control to get that out. So hopefully it'll slide through before we have to, you know, changing of the guard.
Yeah. Well, the congressmen were saying that they didn't expect it to go through intact. They knew that there were going to be some negotiating. And what I'm wondering is, and I really ought to talk to, I guess, Chris and Mike, mm-hmm. is if this is active negotiating between the parties who are interested, between the league and the CAI, or if this is all happening at congressional staff. And maybe Congress people.
I don't know if Congress people are doing this right now. I think there's some negotiations with the league and CAI, but there has not been very much of a success. I think the league is willing to work with CAI. I think that they've been somewhat difficult as far as trying to work out a compromise. Of course, you know, Mike and Chris would know the best about this because they're actively involved in it. But from the information that I've seen, it just looks like, look, we're willing to work out a compromise, but just say no is off the table.
Yeah. So we'll see how it works out. It sounds like they are battling it out behind the scenes directly between League and CAI, which I didn't know how that was going. So, yeah, I got to go bother Chris and Mike again, get them on the show. Mm-hmm. Still the case that if your congressperson is, especially if they're on the Energy and Commerce Committee, mm-hmm. because they're the next people that will put their fingers on this, that they need to hear from you. And even if they're not, eventually every congressperson will have something to say about it. If the language changes in the House, then the language has to change in the Senate. The bills have to be identical before they're passed. I remember this from a week ago when I studied up on it.
Okay.
Certainly not from high school. I didn't pay any attention back then.
Well, we have, this is going to be a year that we're going to have to move very strongly on this. The Democratic and Republican conventions will come up, and that will slow things down. And I understand there's a rapid movement through a bills after that towards the end of the year, but we have a lot to do in a very short time.
I don't know if you guys watched the show that had, I put up all the video from the House committee as they were talking about this, both in, I guess, February and in March. And interesting to hear those people talk about us. Did either of you guys get a chance to see that?
I haven't seen that one, Gary.
Neither did any of you out there. Congress is talking about us. It doesn't take long to watch. my impression was that we were getting a little bit of a pat on the head, and this is clearly not the most important thing they've got to do.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's no big surprise there.
Oh, no. There are bigger fish to fry, I think, in some areas, and that's what, yeah. You know. The squeaky wheel gets the grease, though.
Yeah. Well, in this case, the less our head is stuck up over the weeds, the less could get chopped off.
That's true.
So maybe this can get through. I'm still going to be surprised, but once it hit the Senate, I'm a lot less surprised.
Right.
So
we've done well, and I'm very happy as far as this has gone. Amateur radio has never gone this far before, and I'm really happy. And the other thing is that amateur radio, they know who amateur radio operators are now. They've had a lot of visits, and my guess is there's probably not one person in the Congress or House of Representatives that does not know what an amateur radio operator is. So that's one of the great side benefits of this.
Good deal. Mm-hmm. So write your congressperson. The League website, just Google Parity Act ARRL, and you'll get to the ways to do this, and it's not that hard to do.
And if I could help, ARRL.org/AmateurRadioParityAct, or just look at ARRL.org, and there's what the web developers call breadcrumbs at the top that says Amateur Radio Parity Act. And be sure to watch the video.
Yeah, they put together a good video.
It's very good.
Not as good as ham radio now, but
we're not in competition now.
Yeah. Item 3 on our agenda. We talked about the first item that is up at the FCC for comments, and at the same time, exact same day, also with a March 22 deadline, is a proposal to restructure the bottom of the 80-meter band to add 50 kilohertz of Morse and data. Well, Morse can be anywhere, but 50 kilohertz of exclusive Morse and data, and take that away from phone. A couple of other minor things. Well, the minor, unless they really affect you, and that is to add data mode capability for novices and technicians on 80 and 15 meters. They'd never had that before.
Mm-hmm.
So here's where we may be leaving you in the dark, Jeff. But feel free to interject or ask questions. But I know Jim has been studying up on this because I said, we're going to talk about this.
Well, I mean, I can tell you what my feeling is, that, you know, the 80 meter band is crowded as it is from the phone standpoint, especially during certain times of the day.
You don't operate 80 meters. You operate DMR.
Well, I know. But anyhow, I do listen to 80 meters every once in a while. I can see there's going to be pushback from those who operate on 80 meters from
their
voice.
Is.
I mean, it's going to be they're a vocal group up there, no doubt in my mind.
I got my extra so I could have that extra space, and I had to work hard for it.
I think that was a pun.
Yeah,
go ahead.
But you know, I mean, as you say, you know, the data portion of this is evolving. You know, everything from WISP to, you know, all kinds of different modes that are out there now.
Okay, so here's where Jeff's digital roots are
free
showing.
Free DV, you know, all that stuff. So there's a lot of stuff now that's coming out. And, you know, obviously in order to keep the interest, especially in the, you know, the technician class licenses and stuff like that, I mean, I think you kind of have to consider it. Now, again, depending upon who you talk to, everybody's going to have their own opinion as to, okay, if I'm going to have to take... I'm gonna have to give up some of this band for these people, and you know, I think it'll be a challenge. But I mean, it's something that needs to be considered.
Yeah. The League's position, and this is a petition filed by the League, and their position is, well, first of all, 10 years ago, when the 80 meter band got reshuffled, nobody expected the phone band to go down to 3600. Everybody, the notice of proposed rulemaking before the FCC made it a rule was 3725 or something like that. And then suddenly, wham, the phone band is 90% or 80% of the 80-meter band. What the heck?
Okay, I'm going to say from the ARRL standpoint is we had nothing to do with this. Nothing whatsoever. I mean, I was section manager at the time, and I was not
which part of it?
With the part of dropping the phone band all the way down to 3600.
Right. That wasn't an ARRL position at the time, 10 years ago.
And it, we were surprised. I mean, I just looked at this and I said, okay, what in the world is the justification for this? Because extras were given quite a bit more. But as you'd notice, $37.50 and above were the was the extra. I think $37.75 was advanced, and then $39 up was general, if I remember right. And they dropped it all the way to $3,600. Well, I started out in CWNTS, so I spent a lot of time in the lower part of the 80 meter band, doing nets, and I believe my net was somewhere around 3,625. Well, all those nets and data were all shuffled down to below 3,600, causing incredible crowding. And even though I'm not doing CW nets now, basically you would have one net frequency and then people would go up or down 5 kilohertz to be able to pass traffic. So with all of the nets that are around, that had got to be incredibly difficult. And as, to this day, I still don't know the justification that was why they did that. But it's caused a lot of angst with the CW and digital, and it's kind of kept parties together or pushed parties together and to potentially cause unintentional interference.
Yeah. Now that he's retired, I'm going to blame Bill Cross. I'm making this up entirely, mm-hmm. Bill, that he was an 80-meter phone operator, mm-hmm. and he wanted more space. But don't know that well, that's the case. I thought when I saw it, I thought, this is a typo. You know, they got a wrong digit, and they're going to fix this next week. Well, they did make a mistake. Mm-hmm. They left the automatic station exclusive section or automatic station permissible section up in the phone band where they couldn't operate data.
Now that you mention, yeah. I do remember that.
Yeah. Yeah. And the league said, well, okay, let's the way to fix this is just move the CW and data band back up a little bit, mm-hmm. to where, you know, where that spectrum was. And that's not what the FCC did. They moved the automatic stations allocation down below 3,600, making things even tighter.
Well, we do get a few good ideas, but the FCC is not bound to go by the ideas. Yeah. So the thing was, we tried. And the latest thing you're talking about in the proposal, I hesitate to say this was member-driven. However, only over 1,000 members came in and added input to what the league finally presented in this petition.
Yeah. It was part of a bigger inquiry by the league to members about band planning in general.
Mm-hmm.
Something that I saw go by and didn't spend very much time educating myself on. But this is the only part that goes to the FCC. Everything else is voluntary.
Well, the interesting thing is our new president, Rick Roderick, K4UR, had headed up the committee of the HF band planning. And he started discussing this in the boardroom, and I said, Rick, I need a chart. I really need a chart.
You can't tell the players without a scorecard.
Because the numbers were all over the place. So then he brought out the charts, and I said, okay, this really makes sense. And then they put it out to members, they got their input, and their HF band plan committee came through with what I think is an excellent proposal. We only have one problem. It's going to involve FCC interaction. And we're hoping that they are going to go along with it, because all the things that were planned for the 80-meter band plan, which you're talking about, is going to be dependent on the FCC action.
Yep. So this is up for comments again. Not a notice of proposed rulemaking. It's a request, a petition for rulemaking that the FCC has accepted and said, tell us what you think. There are comments out there. Mm-hmm. The hams that like the idea are probably outnumbered by the hams that don't, which mm-hmm. is no big surprise. That's just usually when people don't like something, they're going to speak mm-hmm. up more than if they do. The hams that like it just basically say, what the ARL said, I like that. Mm-hmm. And the hams that don't are all over the map. But surprisingly literate, mm-hmm. a few of them are not. and some of them, I looked at more than a dozen, and my sample mm-hmm. is a little bigger than that. Mm-hmm. Some of them don't, either they don't understand or I don't understand, because they just got their facts wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And then the others, the general gist of it that I got was sort of along the lines of, I took the extra test so I could have more elbow room. I deserve to keep it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's along the lines of nothing ever changes. Things should remain static. There's no good reason to change anything ever. So because I'm losing a little bit of mine, things shouldn't change. But that's just been the past 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Before that, we didn't have it. I was True. An extra before that. We didn't have it. So.
Well, I also looked at those.
We're not losing all of what we got.
Oh, no, not even
small
close.
Piece of it.
And I'll leave.
I'm going to get email.
Oh, of course you are. We all do. And the thing is whenever someone takes a leadership role, you're open to criticism. It just happens that way. If you go up to reporting or give an opinion, you'll get criticism. There's no way around that. But if you're doing it for the right purposes, and part of amateur radio is you want everybody to enjoy the hobby. And the thing is with all of the digital and CW people being pushed down to the bottom of the phone band, there's a lot of problems with interference, which interferes with the enjoyment of the hobby.
Yeah.
And when you come down to numbers, you know, you got 30, you would lose 50 kilohertz. I'm trying to remember all that. 50 kilohertz. And you've got from, 3650 all the way up to 4,000. There's a lot of space there.
Yep. Mm-hmm. It gets crowded.
Mm-hmm.
I tried to listen as sort of a sample survey mm-hmm. over the past. Not sure what. tires on a cement mm-hmm. floor, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I tried to listen and do a sort of a survey. I only got a couple nights worth. One night, mm-hmm. things were pretty empty. Mm-hmm. One night, things were pretty busy. So mm-hmm. kind of like 50-50.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll light Jeff's eyes up again here. I think digital is the deal. Because more and more digital operating is going to be happening. And to have them stuck below 3,600 is going to be a problem.
Well, as technology evolves, which we know it already has been, I mean, everybody's moving towards digital. And so, you know.
Well, not everybody.
Well, let's say a lot of people are moving towards digital.
I see fingernails firmly grasping the firmament.
Yeah. No, I'm never going digital.
Yeah, I know. It's one of those things that's, you know, I say it's inevitable because, and if you look at the way the FCC is doing it, I mean, obviously they're chopping the pie into smaller pieces. And the way that they do that, obviously, is to, you know, cut the bandwidth down, and we cut the bandwidth down, that means more channels. It means more channels available for do this, that, and the other. So, I mean, you know, when is amateur radio going to really take and grab a hold of digital? It's a good question, totally. But, you know, I know that there'll be a lot of people that'll be resisting that just because of the word digital. But, you know, we'll just have to see how it all plays out.
And those are all the people that are remembering to renew their license every 10 years.
There you go.
Yeah.
I
was going to say I hesitate to bring this up. I don't hesitate to bring this up. I don't ever hesitate to bring anything up. I'm going to revel.
Gary, you don't hesitate to bring anything up.
No, I'm going to revel in bringing this up. I keep bumping the camera that is pointing at Jim here. 10 years ago, the ARL proposed something called regulation by bandwidth. Do you remember that?
Vaguely.
I do, and I will tell you at the time. I tried to find out a number of things about it and see what the advantages were, what drove it in the first place. And it just turned out to be an incredible amount of angst around of many amateur radio operators, and the league took a lot of hits on this. And I was trying to see what the problem was and what the grief was.
What did you find?
Well, I found that a lot of people were not happy with the automatically controlled digital stations or the wider digital stations, and they felt that this entire band plan had entirely everything to, or not, I'm sorry, not band plan, but the bandwidth had everything to do with that. And I think
maybe we should explain what regulation by bandwidth really was, because I'm sure there's a lot of people that, you know, have fuzzier memories than even Jeff does about it.
Okay.
Because it's pretty simple.
And you probably have it, but I do want to make one distinction really quick. The matter before the FCC that we just discussed about the refarming of the bands has nothing.
We're still talking about that.
Nothing to do with this. This is a totally different thing. But
I'm just tossing it on the heap. I'm adding gasoline to the fire. That's what I'm doing.
Well, the thing is, I had to look it up because I was trying to figure out exactly what they had. And they were looking at bandwidths of 200 hertz.
Let me see if my memory is good.
Oh, go ahead.
200, 500, 3 kilohertz with an exemption for AM and something called ISSB.
Independent sideband.
Of 6 and 9 kilohertz.
Yes. It's close. It's 200 would permit CW at all speeds that human operators can decode as well as PSK31. Which is interesting because I know there's a ham that can interpret 205 words per minute.
Okay.
So that's an interesting one.
For more than two characters in a row?
I don't. I've never met him. I don't know how he does it. But anyway, the second was 500 hertz bandwidth would accommodate Ridian data modes and possibly some new image modes. 2.8 kilohertz would remain in the bandwidth for 60 meter operation on upper sideband. 3.5 would accommodate sideband and digital image, high-speed data, and multimedia. We don't want to leave out FM. So that is 16 or 9 kilohertz for double sideband AM. 16 is a reasonable compromise bandwidth to permit analog FM voice data, digital voice, and multimedia at 29 to 29.7.
Yeah, just up there on top of 10 meters.
So there were a lot of things on this, and those
various bandwidths would be set primarily the 200, 500, 3.5 kilohertz for most of the HF bands is what we're talking about, and that would be the way the bands would be subdivided.
And it would be an advantage because, as you know, and I need to say this. I'm a DMR person too. I have a DMR repeater and everything. But anyway, the thought is that we have a lot of things that are put in as designators. In fact, DMR at one time was not felt to be legal because the designator was not listed.
I thought it was because the guys who run it are all kind of dumb.
Okay, look, I think we both got a hit on that one.
There we go.
But the whole idea is that this sort of a proposal would have taken care of that. It said, look, we don't care what you do as long as you keep it in a certain bandwidth.
And it probably still have that published coding or, you know.
Yeah.
You can't invent your own scheme, so nobody can copy it. It's got to be something
else. As long as it's in public domain and it was a certain bandwidth. So I think there were a lot of advantages to that, but it basically died because there was just a lot of negative things towards it. So it's
I'm going to go out on my own limb and say that it's because hams have their heads firmly planted in, I'm going to say, be polite and say, in the sand.
Well, like that,
and the other place that could be planted, Donald Trump would say, but I'm not going to say. But I think it's because, and a lot of them were league members, so the league pretty much had to swallow the deal because they proposed it and they pulled it back.
Yeah.
And they said, whoa, this is not going over with the people that pay our bills. So we're... No.
I think it was just unpopular at the time, and what you do is you bring it back, you reformulate it, and see what the best direction was. And then, of course, you know, we're dealing again with the 3600 to 4000, and what to do or how to get that done. But the new thing, it's very important to say that it has nothing to do with regulation by bandwidth.
It doesn't. It absolutely does not.
No, it does not.
And I'm bringing that up in part a red herring, in part to just because I thought it was a great idea at the time. As we learn more and more about digital modes, it just appeals to me more and more. And I wonder if we lost our one chance to do it because we were too early.
And I don't know. All digital, we all need bandwidth. We all need bandwidth, and one of the advantages of the proposal that it's up is these automatically controlled stations would be moved into accordance with the IARU band plans of Region 1 and 2, and then it would let the narrowband digital be under 3600, and they would kind of have their own homes. Of course, that's a voluntary band planning. But it's an idea that would allow more people to enjoy the hobby.
automatically controlled stations had been something of a mystery to me for a long time until I did a little more research last night. Mm-hmm. And let me see if I've got this right. For HF, mm-hmm. we're primarily talking about HF right now. A station that is going to initiate its own transmission based on somebody send it a message on the internet, mm-hmm. on VHF, you know, packet or whatever. So a message arrives, and this station's job is to forward that out to some other station. That can be done without human intervention on a very small piece of spectrum in the band, I think 15 mm-hmm. kilohertz wide. Mm-hmm. An automatically controlled station that is responding to a locally or remotely controlled station, in other words, one that is operated by a live human being. I want to make a joke about some hams not still really being all that live, but I'll try to refrain from that. A station that is operated by a live human being can then interrogate an automatically controlled station, and that station may respond. Mm-hmm. Can't start something by itself, but it can reply. What's the problem?
Well, the thing is I
don't have that right?
I don't know. I don't know because I haven't really been involved in that. I had some of, unfortunately, we had some NTS people here that were going to be here for the interview, and they probably would have a better idea, a better handle, yeah. because there is NTS Deed or NTS Digital that's out there, and there are a number of people that are extremely well-versed in this. But from what I understand is that there has to be some interrogation. I understand that that somehow this listens and shouldn't cause QRM. However, I think in effect it ends up causing some QRM. And that's what was complained about the narrowband digital operators.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, QRM happens.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
When was the last time anybody successfully said, excuse me, old man, the frequency's in use, and whatever it was that came on and started causing QRM went away?
In the QSO parties, I remember someone asking whether or not, can you please change your frequency? No, I'm sorry, I can't. QRZ.
Yeah. So I don't operate those modes. I'm not myself in the middle of that mix. I don't think mm-hmm. either of you guys are. So mm-hmm. I'm not as sensitive to it as I could be if I was one of the guys doing it, and then I'd feel like I got to protect my ox because it's getting gored. Mm-hmm. I think we got a case going here of people just hanging on to what they got and not wanting anything to change, and putting up any defense they can, whether they got a really legitimate problem or not.
I heard about somebody who had interference one time mm-hmm. from mm-hmm. one of those automated stations. At least he thought it was, but I'm not really sure.
I think that's where we live in here, but no one's willing to admit it.
Yeah.
Well, you're going to get email. Actually, what's going to happen is, mm-hmm. you see this little box we're in here on YouTube? Down below, that's where the comments go down there. And the first one is going to say, let Jeff talk.
You're doing a real good job, Gary, so I'm enjoying listening to you. But
I still get comments on the show we did 4 years ago.
Yeah, the DMR. Yes, okay. Yeah. We won't go there.
But I'll go anywhere.
It was good. I mean, I enjoyed it, so I can't complain.
Yeah, but you came to talk to a subject matter expert, and then all you did was give your own opinions. I watched that show. I liked it a lot.
Oh, yeah.
I think it was a good give and take.
Well, I've got it on DVD. I keep it for something I need when I need to go to sleep. But anyhow.
Yeah. All right. So, regulation by bandwidth, although that it is not what is on the table right now.
That's
would
correct.
Solve that problem.
Mm-hmm. Potentially, but obviously it's a hotbed situation that's not to be resuscitated anytime soon. Yeah. I'll use a doctor term.
But I think this is a small Band-Aid on a bigger problem that will keep coming up. One of the things that I think about that is related to this is that the FCC continues to separate the idea of phone and image and data. And these days, much of the digital voice modes carry as much data as they do phone.
Oh, yeah.
50% of the payload represents voice, and 50% is other stuff. And no one's addressing that. So.
Well, I think some other countries, basically, they're just given a chunk of band, and the government says, here's your band.
Yeah.
Do with it what you want.
That's right. That's right. Yep. It's true. Very true.
All right. So, have we solved it?
Probably no resolution at this point, because we do need some help. We need the FCC to look at this and say, look, this is reasonable. Let's move forward on it. And we just have to hope that there will be some action. Otherwise, at least as far as the 80 meters, it's just going to go away. The rest is all voluntary band plan. Yeah.
And wait for another generation of hams, my generation of hams, to die off so we can make some progress.
There you go.
Well,
all right, guys.
All right.
Okay. Well, anyway, thanks, Gary.
Yep. Thank you, Gary. Appreciate it.
I believe it's time. There's no one left in the building. Elvis has left the building.
Well, we closed another ham fest.
There you go.
I did want to, I'm disappointed that the NTS guys had to go, because I was going to use a line, and they're going to be at the Raleigh Ham Fest, and I'm going to get a chance to talk to them. I think this is, they're a little North Carolina centric or the East Coast centric. So we'll have to pretend that they're talking to people all over the country. Mm-hmm. But as I walk by booths that have NTS on the, you know, the sign, and the, you know, the guy sitting at the table, and they want to talk to you about it, I'm thinking CW nets, voice nets, where people laboriously are transmitting messages. Your license, it's like the slow talker guy that your license is about to expire. I spell echo, X-ray, papa. And so Bill Marine, N2COP, your vice director, was telling me, no, that's not what it's all about. And this still exists to, you know, keep the old guys from complaining too much. But no, they're getting heavy-duty digital, something I thought was a good idea, but wasn't happening back 10 years ago, so...
Well, things have changed, and I related a story when I was working at in New York State Fair with the amateur booth, and we were sending messages, and we actually used one of the very rarely used modes, RIDI, to actually send larger volumes of traffic to someone who is kind of a high-level traffic handler. So it happened back in the 70s, but we've got a lot of modes now.
That was clack, 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 clack.
Yeah, a little bit. To some of the Western Union equipment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I had a Model 15. I was at the ARRL forum earlier today at the Hamfest, and one of the guys was talking about the digital modes, and he said two modes that you should have, and one of them was WinLink, and I forget what he said the other one was. And I had never heard anybody get that specific. I've asked in other interviews.
MT63 maybe?
It might have been. Do you remember what he was saying?
I can't remember the actual.
It was a bit more esoteric than he said. Not PSK31.
No. And I'm.
It might have had to been a connected mode.
There was WinMore, and I am blocking WinLink. This. And not WinLink. I want to try to figure out what this is, but
he had picked two,
and I remember seeing a QST article about it as well, and it handles a number of different protocols, if I remember right.
Because we live in our own Tower of Babel, with so many modes, especially digital modes now. It's not that hard on digital data to have one thing that does them all. FL Digi and a bunch of other programs, I guess, do.
Oh, yeah.
If not every one of them, they're not hard to come by. Digital voice, we're not there yet. You know, we still have walled gardens of digital voice. But the text-based data modes, you can sort of achieve my dream of, well, you tune in something, you push a button, and figure out what your software figures out what it is, and you start to decode it. And the rest of my dream goes like this. You guys are going to enjoy this. This is more for voice than anything else. You tune in something in on a digital mode that's been created for voice. And whether it's VHF or HF, doesn't matter. And you don't have the codec for it. And so you push a button, and your radio captures a little bits of it, sends it out over the internet to some repository that recognizes what it is, sends you back the codec. It's automatically installed in your radio. Now you can operate that mode, and this only takes 5 seconds. And your radio has been storing that transmission and plays it back to you at 1.5 times real-time speed, so you catch up and don't miss a thing.
Like a DVR, right?
I was going to, yes, a DVR for amateur radio digital modes.
There you go.
How long until that happens?
Hey, it's probably going to happen, you know, within the next whenever. I mean, you know, talk to the guys at HRD, you know, Ham Radio Deluxe. I mean, I bet they're doing work on that right now.
Could be. Well,
who knows?
But I'm talking about digital voice.
Well, again, yeah, the data same thing.
Yeah.
So.
Well, no, we are in a serious walled garden on digital voice.
Yeah.
ICOM is got D-Star. Mm-hmm. Yaesu now has Fusion. Kenwood, we're not sure what they're going to do, but they're probably going to have to do something sometime soon.
Next Edge.
DMR. Yeah, mm-hmm. DMR is becoming very popular, but still no ham radios. And the promise of radios that will do them all, but no actual existing radios that can. In fact, no ham radios that do DMR at all yet.
Well, not from the big three. I mean, yeah. they have CSI radios now that do DMR in addition. And actually, the others are commercial.
I guess you could call the CSI a ham radio.
It's all software. I mean, it's all software. They use the same vocoder, AMBE plus to 2 plus, whatever. And, you know, I mean, it's just how the software is written and how it's licensed. Yeah. That's what it comes down to.
It's like K7VE said at the Tapper conference, 95% the same. 100% incompatible.
Yeah.
So I just thought I'd toss that out as a little extra because we haven't even filled up our whole hour yet. We're just getting close. But you guys want to go home.
Yeah, so. I'm going to go.
Yeah. So. All right. Thank you very much. Let's wrap this puppy up. I didn't mention Arvin at any point, so here at the end I will when no one is still watching. If you enjoy these programs and get something out of them and aren't too mad at me for things that I've said, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. Visit Arvin, click the pig, and you can make a contribution that helps pay for all these cameras that are sitting around here and the microphones and hauling them all around the country, which I kind of like doing. So, Jim Boner, N2ZZ, Jeff Parker, I don't call you Mike,
you
Jeff
go.
Parker, WA1WXL. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73. All together. Do you guys know how this closes? All together.
No. Give me a hint.
I do.
It's bad radio procedure. Dick Tracy radio procedure.
Oh.
Over
and out.
Out. Right. All right.
Okay.
All right.
We're done. Thank you.
Thank you, Gary.
Yeah, that's gonna make a lot of people mad.